When a deadly tornado ripped through the small town of Pilger, Nebraska.
It's ripping up a whole town.
It's these mountains. Get past these mountains. Past the hill, mountains.
No, it's not. Wrong side. Actually, that's rotating as well.
Anyone in here?
I don't think we can catch
again storm
seed
on the road network.
This is a. You guys are okay? Good, they're okay.
There's an old Chinese proverb that says all good things come in pairs. But as it turns out, even nightmares come in twos. Because on June 16th, 2014, the tiny town of Pilger, Nebraska became the epicenter of an extraordinarily rare tornado phenomenon. Two EF4 tornadoes spawned simultaneously from the same parent supercell, tracking side by side in a nearly parallel path. These sister or twin tornadoes, as they came to be known, were each responsible for one fatality, and together caused millions of dollars in damage across multiple counties. But the twinning twisters weren't the whole story. They were only part of a five-tornado family that tore through northeast Nebraska that day. This setup didn't just rattle the science community, it rewrote what we thought we knew about tornado behavior. If you're even remotely aware of tornadoes, I'm sure you've heard terrifying stories about EF4s and EF5s ripping towns and cities apart like thin sheets of paper. But while they dominate headlines and documentaries, tornadoes of that scale are actually incredibly rare events, even in the heart of Tornado Alley. The United States, which averages about 1,200 tornadoes annually, only sees about 3 to 4 EF4s per year across all 50 states, coast to coast. So think about it, an entire year's worth of violent EF4s were just concentrated in a single state on a single day. Worst? Two of them tracked just 4 miles apart, sandwiching a tiny town that had never experienced a deadly tornado in its entire recorded history. That town was none other than Pilger, a place so small some residents didn't even consider it a town, just a quiet village they called home. In 2014, Pilger, Nebraska was home to only 352 people. It was a place where every neighbor knew whose truck was parked where, where everybody banked at the same place, and where one small middle school held everyone's kids. Yes, this town had seen its fair share of EF0 and EF1s over the years. It's Nebraska, after all. But deadly tornadoes? There was no historical record of one ever hitting Pilger. Now, Pilger wasn't the only victim of this tornado frenzy June 16th. 10 miles to the southwest, Stanton, which was larger than Pilger, but still very much rural, was also impacted by the earliest EF4 tornado from the storm family on this day. Then, 8 miles to the northeast, there was Wakefield, which was also struck by a separate tornado from the same parent supercell. Altogether, 5 tornadoes touched down in northeastern Nebraska that afternoon. But before we talk about the devastating D-Day, let's talk about the meteorological signs that led up to that moment. What exactly made June 16th, 2014 so special? How is it possible for these 3 individually rare phenomena to happen in one afternoon? A year's worth of EF4 tornadoes hit one state in a single day. 2 EF4s spawned side by side from the same supercell, tracking a nearly parallel path. Pilger, which was never prone to violent tornadoes, was hit so violently that about 75% of it was destroyed. Well, here's the plot twist. The setup wasn't even that special, at least not at first. On June 13th, 3 days before the outbreak, the Storm Prediction Center, SPC, noted broad signs of instability that could result in severe weather across the northern United States. An upper-level trough digging into the western US, and a surface low forming in the central plains. It looked like something could form anywhere from June 16th to June 18th, if it was going to form at all. At this point, the forecast was vague, just a big maybe. But the next day, June 14th, things shifted slightly. The SPC upgraded the outlook to a slight risk after noticing more focused signs. a strengthening low-level jet, and rising instability as warm air surged in from the south. Instead of a possibility, the forecast flagged a real risk, especially around where the Big Sioux and Missouri rivers meet the Sioux City tri-state area of Iowa, Nebraska, and South Dakota. Still, nothing to panic over. By June 15th, conditions held steady, at least for the most part. Behind the scenes, there was a quiet but critical shift. Moisture from the Gulf of Mexico began surging northward, and dew points began to rise across Nebraska and Kansas, both of which are classic signs of an increasingly unstable atmosphere. June 16th, 2014. The atmosphere suddenly became far more volatile than the days prior. The SPC upgraded the forecast to a moderate risk for severe weather in northeast Nebraska, a label that isn't handed out lightly, especially not in this region. There was a 10% chance of tornadoes, a 30% chance of damaging winds, and a 30% chance of baseball-sized hail. For local residents, these warnings meant reviewing safety plans, clearing basements, and keeping an ear glued to NOAA weather radios. But for storm chasers, this was another adventure time. By midday on June 16th, 2014, a powerful cyclic supercell thunderstorm had developed and was now dominating the skies over northeastern Nebraska. The SPC and local NWS offices were on high alert. Sky watchers, amateur chasers, and professional meteorologists alike began converging and coordinating, many of them zeroing in on this storm. And then, at 3:42 p.m., the first EF4 tornado touched down about 10 miles southwest of Stanton. This tornado initially caused limited damage, snapping trees and power lines. But as it moved northeast across Highway 24, it intensified rapidly, leveling two farmsteads and destroying several more structures in its path. West of Stanton, it flattened the wooden power poles, tore apart outbuildings, flipped semi-trucks, and completely leveled two homes as it danced just outside the town center.
Anybody here?
And before that first EF4 tornado near Stanton had ever dissipated, at around 4 p.m., another EF4 tornado touched down just outside of Pilger. This would soon become known as the Pilger tornado, the first of the two deadly twins. It started narrow and relatively weak, but as it neared the Elkhorn River and closed in on town, it rapidly intensified into a violent wedge. Moments later, a second tornado, nearly identical in size and power, formed just south of town. This one would become known as the Pilger East Tornado, and it placed Pilger directly between two violent EF4s. At this point, the Pilger Tornado had begun rummaging through the homey, tight-knit town of Pilger, tearing through homes, businesses, and landmarks in a matter of seconds.
Can anyone hear me?
There are dozens of videos captured by storm chasers that show the twin tornadoes from a distance. However, there aren't many clips that show the destruction of these twisters when Pilger was hit up close. Still, by piecing together the wide shots of the massive Pilger wedge, damage photos from the aftermath, and first-person accounts from survivors, anyone can begin to imagine how terrifying that tornado impact was for a town of just 352 people. At the time the tornado struck, Midwest Bank, the main bank in the town of Pilger, was open. As the twister approached, the branch manager directed everyone inside into the vault. He locked it from the outside, risking his own life to save the others, and then ran for a nearby crawl space. The twister hit. Moments later, the bank's building was completely obliterated. Fortunately, though, everyone inside the vault survived unscathed. The manager was safe as well. Perhaps it was his guardian angel who looked out for him as he saved a dozen lives. The town's middle school, which served 5th and 6th graders, was gutted just 2 months before the new school year. For the residents, it wasn't just a school, it was a landmark. The place where multiple generations of Pilger residents had graduated. It was almost a rite of passage. Across the street, a church was also destroyed, everything from its walls to the organ was tossed into a nearby cornfield. Homes in every direction were reduced to twisted piles of debris. Even the grain bins of the former co-op, one of Pilger's largest employers, were torn open. Steel panels were scattered far outside town. Only the spilled mounds of grain marked where the bins had stood. As everyone tried to hide, protect loved ones, and hold out, the Pilger tornado threatened not just the people's survival, but the entire community's existence as a whole. After tearing through Pilger, the original tornado briefly weakened. Footage from storm chasers showed its funnel starting to lift and thin out, a sign it might be dissipating. But minutes later, as Pilger East tornado reached peak intensity, the original tornado, one that had already torn through the heart of town, briefly showed signs of reorganizing. Its condensation funnel tightened again, and for a moment, the two twisters drifted closer together. At one point, they were just about a mile apart, close enough for storm chasers to capture some of the most jaw-dropping tornado footage ever recorded. Two violent EF4 tornadoes spinning side by side on the open plains. The combined inflow from both was so intense, it leveled an anchor-bolted home and hurled a car into a basement. The Pilger East tornado continued its rampage through the countryside, destroying three farmsteads before finally lifting around 4:32 p.m. But at that point, the original Pilger tornado wasn't done yet. It crossed the path just vacated by its twin and charged into Wayne County, where it took out another home, collapsed a metal truss transmission tower, and wiped out an outbuilding. It finally began to wind down as it approached the developing Wakefield circulation, the fourth tornado spawned by the same supercell. That one would go on to destroy three more farmsteads. For a brief moment, the two tornadoes, Pilger and Wakefield, appeared in frame together, creating a second twin twister moment, though this one was short-lived and less intense. The damage from the true twin tornadoes became unmistakably clear once the greenish veil of clouds and emergency vehicles began pouring in. Pilger, already a small rural town, lost nearly 75% of its structures. Homes, schools, and businesses were destroyed. Many residents had to relocate permanently. Before the tornadoes, Pilger had a population of 352. When the town began to reopen in the following months, that number had dropped to just 160. Infrastructures weren't the only things that were lost. During the storm, two people were also killed. In Pilger, a 5-year-old girl died when her family's mobile home was hit directly. A 74-year-old man also lost his life to the other twin. At least 20 others were injured, though the swift arrival of ambulances and first responders helped prevent further tragedy. Compared to major urban tornado disasters, these numbers might seem modest, but for Pilger and the surrounding communities, they were more than enough to cause widespread grief, job losses, and long-term displacement. Here's how one of the residents described the memory 2 years after the tornadoes touched down.
It was the worst feeling in the world. To see what the town had accomplished in the 28 years I've been here, to just get to see it all ripped up.
You may have seen other tornadoes touch down at the same time, but chances are they weren't true twins. Most were what you'd call main satellite pairs, where a dominant tornado is orbited briefly by a weaker, short-lived one. What happened near Pilger was different. These were two independent EF4 tornadoes, both long-lived, fully mature, and tracking side by side. They weren't orbiting each other, they were coexisting. That kind of synchronized intensity requires a perfect storm of ingredients in the atmosphere. Massive instability, intense wind shear, and boundaries like the outflow that helped trigger this storm. Some compare these tornadoes to the 1990 Heston-Gossel tornado family in Kansas, but that event involved a cyclic supercell producing successive tornadoes, not simultaneous, independent EF4s. The infamous Palm Sunday 1965 outbreak also featured so-called twins, but those were likely satellite tornadoes, multi-vortex twisters, or just successive touchdowns from rapidly cycling storms. There's no other recorded event like Pilger's twin EF4s in modern weather history. It's often referred to as a meteorological anomaly, something still not fully completely understood, even by the scientists who study these storms for a living. And honestly, I wouldn't be surprised if, in our lifetime, the Pilger twins end up being the only true twin tornadoes the world will ever see. It's not uncommon for a small town the size of Pilger to disappear entirely after being hit by a natural disaster, especially one on the scale of what the Twin Twisters caused. But living up to its saying, "too tough to die," Pilger pushed through even after losing more than 3/4 of its infrastructure and about half of its population. Of course, though, it was nowhere near easy. It took about a month just to finish the basic cleanup of debris and damages the storm had caused. For up to 2 years after the tornadoes, many lots where homes and businesses once stood remained empty. The tornadoes displaced nearly 200 people from Pilger in just a matter of minutes. To put that into perspective, the current population has just crept back up to around 288, according to the latest census data. Yes, the town is slowly rebuilding, but one way or another, it has never truly been the same again. And with every year that passes, Pilger becomes more of a different community than the one it was before June 16th, 2014.